Tell me about deep learning.
Maybe it gets slightly mathy, okay? But we can just go after with an example to see what things are, right? But you know, one typical example is if someone wants to assess automatically what is the price of a property. So there are certain variables that are important for property, you know, x1, x2, to whatever, xn. You know, this might be the square meters, this is like a year of construction, whatever else, right? And then the most simple way of finding an estimated value is to say, okay, I'm going to do this, a1, a2, an, plus, you know, usually we you have a bias term, something like that. This gives you the estimated price, yeah? You can represent it like this, right? You have the input variables, and then you have your output variable, and then you do this, meaning that you have this value, you have an A1 here, and AN here, and all of this is summed here into this summation.
Okay, so for instance, the larger the building, the higher the number,
yeah.
maybe the newer the house and
yeah.
the more valuable it is or
yeah.
whatever.
Yeah, of which floor, whatever, right? So this is just a weighted combination of certain factors, right?
So it all comes out a big number, right?
It will, yeah. Hopefully you will have more or less accurate way, right, of describing the prices. So how do you learn this thing, right? So you can just, you know, decide yourself. You put the 7 here, more or less what comes out makes sense, right? But so usually you just find, say, 100 examples, right? If you're interested in doing this, maybe you have, you know, a backlog of houses sold, right? And then you more or less, you know, plot the value. In order to visualize it, we do it with only one variable, which is the square meters, right? So you have one example here, another here, right? And you have this cloud of examples, right? So this means like each one of these x's is, you sold a house that has, you know, this number of square meters for this price over here, yeah? And then you try to more or less feed that, right? So you can say, I'm gonna do like straight line, right? That will tell me, you know, what is the relation between the square meters and the value, yeah? So now, tomorrow, someone tells you, you know, I have like this 80 square meters house, what is the price, right? And then you come here and you say, okay, the price is this, yeah? Which is the best line? You don't know, right? That is the question. You say maybe a line is not a good thing, right? So you will use a quadratic function, right? Because, you know, like maybe larger houses, they're more, they're not so easy to come by and usually have higher end, so you know things will not grow linearly.
So it's a curved line, for those who are not mathematical, it's a curved line possibly.
Yeah, it's a curved line that will involve more variables, right? And this means that you can fit things that are not so straight, right? So you have more flexibility in what you can model, right? But this comes at the cost of having more variables to describe the model, right? And there's always this type of relation, right? You have more power to represent something, and then you can capture fake correlations, right? So how to, which kind of model is best, this is something that is not clear at all, right? It's not like just throw as many variables as you can and will fit better, right? Because you will be doing something that is called overfitting, which is you will be overestimating how well you do things, right? So maybe if you put enough variables, right, and you have a set of points, right, and then you will do this, right, and you say, okay, I exactly predict everything, right? But then, you know, the reality is that at some point you will get something there and you're totally wrong, yeah? So many parameters make things hard to optimize, right? So in a flat structure, you have all of these, and then you have this variable that is the summation, yeah? And this is your output, right? And then you can do, as opposed to this, a deep structure, right?
So is a flat structure is just kind of traditional machine learning, is it?
Yeah, yeah. Neural networks is something that has been around for a very long time. And neural networks can be either shallow, right? Shallow is better. It's better name. A shallow structure, or it can be a deep structure, right?
Shallow learning, we add everything together. We come up with a number. That number gives us a how good is this or how bad is that?
Yeah.
But deep learning, other stuff's going on, right?
Yeah. So there's some variables in the middle, right? In between your input, right? The values that you're able to measure, like the size of the flat or the year of construction. And then something happens that tells you some intermediate variables, right? And then from these intermediate variables, you will get the output, right? You will get the prediction. Or maybe you will put yet another intermediate set of variables and so forth, right? So the idea is you have some compound concepts, right, that might be good for predicting what you want to know. You could have a direct prediction of, you have this kind of structure that would tell you what is the price, yeah? But maybe the most relevant variables in order to decide what is the pricing is not one of these things that we're inputting. You might have to find some concepts that relate to a subset of these in a certain way, and that this is the real important thing, right? So for example, you might want to have either a very large house with several bathrooms, right? Or you might want to have a small house and then having one bathroom is not a problem, right? So this type of concept is a combination of more than one, right? You cannot decide having one bathroom is bad, right? Because it depends on the number of square meters of the house. The idea is that with deep learning, this thing here will not be the price. This will be this intermediate concept, right? And you will say, you know, for example, I will create a concept that you have bathrooms and number of rooms on one variable. And then these other things in here will not really matter, yeah? And then you can have something here that is basically the square meters, you know, like it's an important variable independently of anything else, right? So we will keep this. This is the only thing that will matter for this variable, right? You know, maybe the year is a really good thing to have a new flat, right? But maybe if the property is more than 100 years old, suddenly, you know, it becomes really good, right? And maybe you want to have a concept that says, you know, is this a new property? Or you will have yet another concept that is this a historic property, right? And this will depends on the year, but the type of relation will be different, right? Because suddenly it's not that old is bad, all becomes good, right? So you have to have this set of intermediate concepts, right, in a way that now you can use them to decide on the pricing of your house. And these probably will be more meaningful, more representative of what people seek than just having the pure basic measurable things in isolation. So once you mix and combine, some of these will give you attributes that are better in order to predict. But you can just do it again and again, right? So there's no reason why you have to combine this thing, right, only once, right? And suddenly you want, I don't know, for whatever reason you might have a lot of market for very old houses that actually have an even number of rooms and bathrooms, right? And then you create yet another layer, right? So instead of having these connections directly to the pricing of the house, right, you have yet another connection, right? We said that we had a house with that is really old, so it just went up in value because it's a historical building. And then you have a very good configuration of rooms and bathrooms, right? So this means that, for example, this variable in here that captures whether there's a good balance rooms, bathrooms, will have a high value, right? We say that this variable is active. This will mean that yeah, you have this variable active, you have this one that was the one representing whether the building was becoming historical, right? And with these two things having a high value, then you will have a high value also for this variable over here. That will mean that you get a really high selling price in the end, right? Instead, if you have a really bad combination of room bathrooms, right, this variable in here will have a very low value, and then instead of this variable you will have the other one being active, and you will have a low selling value or lower than the other case, right? So this represents the kind of choices that actually you can make when you reason about things, right? So what do you want? We want not only, you know, like square meters, rooms, bathrooms. You actually take decisions based on the combinations, right? So you will say, well, you know, it is a large flat, but the distribution is really good, right? So this is the kind of combination of two variables, right? Having good distribution and large. Maybe if the flat was large enough, you wouldn't care so much about the distribution, right? And you can keep on having this hierarchical grouping of different variables, right? And the good thing about machine learning is that in the same way that you reason, try to find a correlation that would explain that these things together make sense, the machine is able to find grouping of different variables in a way that you basically have no idea what it means, right? But the machine knows that this is useful to take a decision, right?
So the machine has tried out various different things, and you've told it what the endpoint is, and it's worked out what gives you the most consistent endpoint.
The machine will be able to say, okay, in order to get an accurate prediction, you have to group these variables, right, and create this kind of decision, right? So if you meet all these conditions, then this thing will have a high value, right? And whenever this thing happens, and some other decisions like that happen as well, and they have high values, right, then this thing will happen, right? And you can keep on going really deep in this sense, right? But the idea is that, right? You will take decisions based on these decisions based on the input values, right? So you will combine your inputs into some decisions that are intermediate. They're not really the pricing, right? And then you will have another layer that will decide on the price later on.
If it tolerates you and gives you some idea of what's happening, and you can sort of see where I must be.
And this can represent the other paddle. So we've got two objects with the identical interfaces, one to represent the paddle on the left, one to represent the paddle on the right.